Good morning, welcome back to the webinar series on nonlinear differential problems. This morning, the distinguished lecture will be delivered by Professor Enrico Valdinoci from the Western Australia University. On the behalf of the organizers, I wish to thank a lot Professor Valdinoci for accepting our invitation. His talk sure will be a reach the scientific level of the webinar. Professor Valdinoci will speak about a very interesting topic, a mathematical model for civil wars, a new Locta Volterra competitive system. Please, Professor Valdinoci.
Thank you, Pasquale, but I think you have been too generous. Now I feel under pressure because you created so much expectation. I'm going to speak about something quite easy after all. It's something new, and that is the reason for which I thought it was a good idea to talk about. But as everything new, I mean, it's kind of a preliminary stage in a sense, because I think we did some things that are kind of interesting already, but of course, since it's a new thing, many things have to be perfected and ameliorated and improved and so on. So it will be an easy topic in the sense because we try to keep the model as simple as possible and to develop the mathematics from scratch. So there will be no abstract or fancy theory going on. But I think it's somehow the beauty of a topic like this, having something simple but not simplistic, and let's see if you like it after all. Okay, so I'm supposed to...
You have to share your screen, okay.
Yes. And you should be able to see the full screen now, right?
Yes.
So the topic I'm gonna talk is this model on civil wars, which is, if you like, a topic in mathematical biology or a little bit of mathematical analysis or a little bit of dynamical systems. And it's basically a new Lotka-Volterra type of competitive system. And this is a joint work with Elisa Fili, Serena Di Pierro, and Luca Rossi. And the idea for modeling civil wars is that, well, of course, wars are a bad thing, and civil wars are probably the worst. And of course, when there is a war, in particular a civil war, people have other things to do than collecting data. So it's a situation in which the data available is very limited, and it's of course not really reliable because there are two parties involved, and that there can be a number of biases in the collection of the data. So we wanted to provide a foundation for studying these topics, relying on mathematics. And so on deducting the equations from first principles and try to obtain some interesting consequences. So I will try to, the first part of the talk will be basically a talk in philosophy, not in mathematics. I will try to describe without equations what we are doing. Because the equations can be a little bit complicated, but once you see what is the interpretation, the equation themselves become transparent and everything becomes very, very simple. But so the idea underneath this model is that you have two competitive populations. They compete for the same resource and they are located in the same region. So in the same point, if you like. And the two populations have a very different behavior. So one of the two is aggressive and the other is a pacific population. So there is an aggressive population that can attack the other. And this creates what we call a civil war because the two populations share the same land and resources. And the number of parameters are involved in the equation. So the idea is that the two populations can be somehow different. or in a sense they can be undistinguishable. So the two population can be equally fit to the environment, and so in this sense are indistinguishable up to the fact that the first population is aggressive, or they can have a different fit with respect to the resources. For instance, one of the two can have a better capability of taking advantage of the environmental resources, and this could also be one of the reasons for which the conflict is generated. So our objective as mathematicians is to write down a coherent system of equations. So try to write down something which is simple enough to do mathematics with, but also rich enough to produce some kind of interesting situations. So we want to understand the dynamics of the system generated by this equation, understanding the equilibria, their features like stability, their basins of attraction. And of course, when I say understand this object, I mean to understand their behavior in terms of the different parameters involved in the model, such as the relative fitness and the level of aggressiveness of the first population and how effective the strikes are. So there is a parameter that describes the fact that the first population is going to try to kill the second, and of course it may succeed or not. How effective the strike of the first population is one of the parameters of the model, and we will see in which term this comes into play. And we took the point of view of the first population. So we say victory when the first population wins. I mean, this is not very nice in a sense, because we are taking the point of view of the aggressive population, which is something I personally don't like at a personal level, but it was convenient to look for somehow the best strategies for the first population, which unfortunately are the worst possibilities for the Pacific population. But I think it's a simpler way to communicate the results. So we will study the initial configurations that may lead to the victory of the aggressive population, taking into account the strategies to achieve the victory. So when I mean strategy, I mean that in principle, the aggressive population can play with some of the parameters to turn the war in its favor. So the aggressive population in particular can decide how much war to carry on. So they can adjust the parameter describing their aggressiveness in order to either diminish or exacerbate the conflict with the aim of destroying the second population. So the victory for the first population is when the second population is completely extinct. So the objective of the first population is to kill everybody else. So what are the results that we obtain in our work? Well, the first kind of results deal with the initial data that allow the victory of the aggressive population. The first natural question is whether or not the first population can adjust the aggressiveness parameter in order to win the war, regardless the initial configuration. Initial configuration means how many individuals are, or what is the density, or what the density is of the first and of the second population, okay? Well, the first natural question is, can the first population always win? We will see that the answer is negative. So there exist initial configurations for which the aggressive population cannot make the other population extinct. So the strategy itself is not sufficient to win the war. One has to start already with some good initial configuration. Then the second remark is that the choice of the strategy is really the choice of the aggressiveness parameter is really a strategic choice because can change the situation and the outcome of the war. And you may think in practice that adjusting this strategy is more complicated than what mathematicians think, because of course, as scientists, we take a piece of paper, we write our equation, and we think that this exhausts the war, the world. But it's not like this. Of course, if you have a war going on, and you have to change your strategy to adapt your strategy in the course of the war, well, this is going to be problematic because you have to communicate with the army in a sense. So it would be desirable for the first population to have a constant strategy and win the war. So not only to win the war by adjusting the strategy many times, but just to have a constant strategy so that the general tells what to do to the soldiers, they execute the orders without having to communicate again. And so the natural question when you think in this framework is to decide whether or not constant strategies are sufficient for the first population to achieve the victory. So suppose that you start from an initial situation in which the first population can achieve the victory by choosing an appropriate strategy. Can the first population achieve the victory also choosing a constant strategy? Well, for populations with the same fit to the environment, so for undistinguishable populations, the constant strategies are sufficient. So if you start with an initial configuration that admits any piecewise continuous in time strategy leading to the victory of the first population, then the first population can also choose a constant in time strategy, reaching the victory, okay? But for different populations, for populations which have different fit to the environment, this is not the case. So constant strategies do not exhaust all the winning strategies. This means that there is an initial configuration, initial condition, which in principle allows the first population to win the war, but only choosing an appropriate strategy, which is not constant. So they have to communicate, the generals have to communicate with the soldiers during the war to win. The next step in this analysis is somehow to decide how many times the generals have to communicate to the soldiers. So given our first remark, we know that the generals have to communicate at least once because the optimal strategy is not constant. The natural question is whether or not they can communicate only once. And the answer in this case is positive. So strategies with at most one jump discontinuity are sufficient to win the war. So independently from the relative fit, I mean, if the fit is the same for both, constant strategies are enough. But if the fit is different, the constant strategies are not enough. Regardless, if the initial configuration allows the victory of the first population can also choose to achieve this victory by following a strategy made of two constants with a jump in the middle somewhere. So they only have to change their strategy once and constants are not sufficient in themselves, but once you allow one single jump discontinuity, they are sufficient to win the war. So this, I think, it's well, it's a good news, unfortunately, for the aggressive population. I'm sorry. I think that there is some kind of helicopter probably patrolling the river looking for sharks. There was the shark attack on the other side of the river a couple of weeks ago. But we can discuss about that, because I think that given the long-range foraging strategies of the sharks, if you believe in levy flights, you would not expect the same shark to attack again in the same point. Or at least this is my theory, and the University Club made an expedition to the place where the shark attacked. We went there. We were very well organized, because the guide said that if someone is lucky enough to see the shark, tells everybody else, we had to raft together and decide what to do. In any case, we didn't see the shark. This confirms to me that the levy foraging strategy is kind of plausible. So the shark had attacked there once, unfortunately, but then went somewhere else. So I think there shouldn't, I mean, if you believe in this mathematical formulation, there shouldn't be any need of sending the helicopter. Anyway, it's coming back, so probably they don't agree with my model of
shark. VR theory.
Let's go back to the civil wars. Of course, when I am saying here that the first population can choose a strategy with only one jump, the fact is that that strategy may not be optimal for other reasons. So it's optimal in terms of minimizing the communication between the generals and the soldiers, but it may provide a longer duration for the war. So another natural question is to study the winning strategies for the first population that minimize the duration of the war. So in this case, we will see that jump discontinuity strategies may not be enough. And one has to sometimes follow a strange, I would say, interpolating arc between bang-bang configurations. Okay, so let's see what the mathematical model is. So there are two populations with density U1 and U2 that depend on time. So it's like an ODE after all, which take values in 0, 1. So it's a density. So for me, 0, it means that there is no one, means that 100% is occupied by either U1 and or U2. And the two populations compete for the same resources with the logistic equation. The real novelty of the model I would like to propose to you is that the clashes do not depend on random encounters. So typically, in most of the mathematical biology models that people study, there is a term that is like the product between U and V, which comes from the idea that there is a random encountering between the two populations. Oh, sorry, I called it here U and V, but with this notation was U1 and U2. So a typical Lotka-Volterra system has a term which is U1 times U2, which comes from the idea that the chance of meeting between the two populations is random. Here, instead, we consider the case in which the conflict is intentionally sought by the first population. So it's just proportional to U1. So the more people U1, the more the damage produced for the second population. So the proportion of U1 that produces a damage to the second population is modulated by some parameters, which will be the level of aggressiveness, that is, what is the proportion of the first population that is sent to war, and by another parameter, that is the effectiveness of the strikes of the first population. Okay, so to describe the logistic equation, of course, as usual, logistic equation tells that for a small density of population, the population will just reproduce with some fertility rate, for instance, Ri. This fertility rate can be the same or different for the two populations. And then if the populations grow too much, this is detrimental for the growing of the population itself. This is the other side of the logistic interpretation, because the resources are finite, so they can only accommodate a finite number of people that we denote, for instance, by this quantity k. And then we denote by A the level of aggressiveness of the first population, and by this zeta I, this death rate due to casualties. So all in all, the system of equation is like this. So you have the first population sees for small densities, just this fertility rate, and then competition kicks in with respect to this parameter k, which is the maximum number of individuals that the resource can accommodate. And then you see in the first equation, there are a number of people which are sent to war. So depending on the parameter A, the larger the A, the more people go to war. And this is in principle detrimental for the growth of the first population, because they go to war, so they don't participate to the reproduction, for instance, or they may die or whatever. And when they go to war, if you see they happen in the second equation, it's almost the same equation. The logistic part is the same up to the different parameters. But the parameter that is different is this zeta 2 here with respect to the zeta 1. So the people of the first population that go to war create a damage to the second population, which is modulated by this zeta 2. So the higher the zeta 2, the more effective the weapons of the first population. The smaller the zeta 2, the less effective these weapons are, and so the less damage to the second population. And of course, you can write the system of equation in a simpler form by changing a bit the time scale, and you reduce the number of parameters. So we prefer to write it in this way. So the first population is just now called U for simplicity. The second population is called V. Then you have a parameter rho, which comes from the ratio basically between R1 and R2. The maximal of the resources is parameterized to be 1. And then little a is the aggressiveness parameter, which is modulated by C, which is the cost of the war. Basically, if you think that the weapons affect the second population with the unit scale, then the cost of the war for the first population is modulated by this parameter C. And so since the goal of the first population is to annihilate the second, we say that U wins the war if there is a time for which V of the time big T, for which V of big T is equal to zero. Okay? And when we were discussing the strategies to be used by the first population, in a mathematical framework, these strategies are collected in this set that we call big A, the level of aggressiveness, collecting all the possible level of aggressiveness, small a. And so for us, this is somehow one of the possible scenarios for the optimal control theory. Well, we take A to be a function which is continuous, except at most at a finite number of points. This is kind of a convenient functional space if you want to do optimization. You can do other choices, but to start with, we thought it was a convenient functional space to work with. So inside the set A, you have another couple of interesting sets. So of course, the easiest possibility is the set that we call K, that is the one of constant functions, which of course is a subset of A. But then there is this intermediate set that is the set of what we call Heaviside functions, that are functions that are piecewise constant, but with one discontinuity. So just one step between two constants. And of course, K is a subset of H, which is a subset of A. And another notion that we use from classical dynamical systems is this of the basins of attraction. So if you think our configuration space is made by a square, because we put U as a basis and V as height, so it's 0, 1 times 0, 1. The basis of attraction, for instance, of the point 0, 1, which corresponds, so it's the set of initial points for which the first population gets instinct, and you can see it's in infinite time, and only the second one survives. So this is somehow the worst possible scenario for the first population. So the first population starts a war to destroy the second population, but this is not good for the first population itself, and it's the first population that gets extinct due to the war. So this is an important set that we want to study. Somehow it's the one that we would support in real life. These are the bad people who die after all. And we call this set B. Instead, we will call E to be the victory basin, that is the set of initial points for which the first population make the second one extinct. So these are the initial configuration for which there exists some time, some finite time, for which the second population gets extinct. So for me, phi t is just the flow of the ODE system that I wrote before at time t. And when I write phi t of u0, v0, I mean the evolution of the ODE starting at the initial point u0, v0. And as typical in dynamical system, the first thing to do is to determine the equilibria and to detect their stability. So we call the dynamical system notation is not uniform about equilibria, but we decided that we took this notation to call sync if all the eigenvalues of the linearized map are strictly negative real parts. So in particular, you have a configuration that looks like this. So the equilibrium is really attractive for the points nearby. But not only that, it's exponentially attractive because the eigenvalues are all strictly negative. A source, vice versa, if they are strictly positive, so it's it's an unstable equilibrium with exponentially fast movements nearby. And the saddle, if the linearized map has an eigenvalue with strictly positive real part and one with strictly negative real part. So it looks like something like this. There is an unstable direction, there is a stable direction, and the motion is hyperbolic nearby with exponential behavior, one in the positive and one in the negative side. Yes, again, things are asymptotically stable, sources are asymptotically unstable, that is asymptotically stable for the reverse time dynamics. And to start with, we provided a linear analysis of the system and to detect the equilibria and their stability. So this analysis relies on the understanding of the different of the role played by the different parameters, and it turns out that the only parameter that really counts for this is the product between A and C. So it's the aggressiveness times the cost of the war, and the threshold is AC equal to one. So when AC is less than one, there are three equilibria. So the origin in which both the populations are extinct, which is a source, which means that life tends to prevail. So if you start nearby the origin, even if you have very few individuals, life prevail and will create some pattern. So there is a second one, which is 0-1, which is a sink. So the 0-1 corresponds to the death of the first population and to the full survival of the second one. And then in the regime AC less than one, there is a third equilibrium, which is a saddle. And this equilibrium can be computed explicitly. Okay, when AC is bigger than one, there are only two equilibria that are 0-1, which is still a sink, and 0-0, which is a saddle. So if you see, the origin changed a bit the stability. So again, it's true that life tends to prevail because there is an unstable manifold for the equilibrium, but there is also a stable one that is collapsing there. And the reason for which there is this bifurcation in the diagram is that when AC is equal to one, you see these values here, one minus AC, one minus AC converge to zero, which means that the third equilibrium, which is a saddle, clashes onto the origin and changes its stability. So the origin, which is a source, clashes with the third equilibrium that is a saddle at when AC is equal to one. And in this case, it produces an equilibrium which has a strictly positive eigenvalue and a null one. This null one will become negative when AC is bigger than one, and that's why it produces the saddle. Okay, then there exists a nice curve. It's a smooth curve which is increasing. It's a graph of an increasing function, and we call it M, which plays the role of a separatrix. So your configuration space, which is the box, is divided into three regions. One region, which is what we were calling B, the basin of attraction corresponding to the victory of the second population, which can only occur in infinite time. The set that we call E, which is the basin of attraction of the of the victory of the first population that occurs possibly in finite time. And these two sets are divided by a smooth curve that we call N. So nothing else can happen. I think this is nice because one can think, or but there could be intermediate situation. Well, actually, the configuration space, the initial configuration space, is split into two, that is B and A, with the curve in the middle. And the trajectories that start on the separatrix tend to the third equilibrium, this USBS, when AC is less than one, and to the origin when AC is bigger or equal than one. So the origin becomes attractive for the trajectories in M in this case. So this also would correspond to the stable manifold of the origin when AC is strictly bigger than one. So the picture is more or less like this. So you can run easily some simulations just to see the different cases. So the first case you see, notice that in all these analyses, the parameter rho, that is somehow the birth rate, plays not a significant role. Okay, so the analysis is qualitatively not sensitive to the parameter rho. Quantitatively, it appears here, but qualitatively, it's not so important. So the first case, AC less than one, is depicted here. So you see these three red dots are the equilibria. And nearby here, you may think that there is the separatrix, like a smooth curve that is the graph of an increasing function. The second case, it's here, AC becomes larger than one. Then you have only two dots because the third clashed against the origin and basically moved all this part, this upper part, here and in this case the separatrix is this monotone graph, or it's nearby this monotone graph. So now to detect the optimal strategies, we need a little bit more of a notation. So the set E was the set of initial points that could lead to the victory of the first population, okay? But this depends on the choice of the strategy taken. So, because if I change A, I change the flow of the equation, right? So E depends on A. And if I want to emphasize it, I describe E as E of A. Then if I have a subset of all the possible strategies, I will call V of T to be the union of the initial points leading to the victory of the first population with respect to the strategy A when A varies in this subset of T. Okay, oh, sorry. So VT is the set of the initial conditions for which the first population can win by choosing strategies in the set T. And of course, the natural question is whether or not there is some special choice of T that is easy to implement and make the first population win. So when rho is equal to one, so when the two populations are indistinguishable in terms of birth rate and fitness to the environment, then the V of A, so the set of initial configurations that allow the victory of the first population can be explicitly described. So it's described by this two equation here. When rho is less than one, can still be described, But it's a little bit more complicated in the sense that you need an additional curve, which is coming basically from the separatrix, that is a power of U. It's a graph like a power-like function. And when rho is bigger than one, well, you still have a similar situation with another curve describing the separatrix that is given by another type of power-like function. And the case rho equal to one is special because not only V of A was easily described, but basically V of any set would have been the same. So for rho equal to one, the constant strategies, which is somehow the easiest and the smallest set you want to put in the framework, produce the same winning possibilities as all the strategies. And they are described exactly the same as before. But when rho is different than one, as I was saying, constant strategies are not sufficient anymore. But the case of the constant fit population is really special. When the two populations have different fit, constant strategies are not sufficient anymore. Nevertheless, Heaviside strategies are. So in this case, even when the fit to the environment is different, the Heaviside strategies are sufficient to recover the victory in any case. Yes, as a quantitative description of the available strategies, let me introduce the set that we call A small m big M. So the idea is that you have to put bounds on how much war a population can do. So suppose that you have two parameters, big M and small m, and suppose that you put an additional constraint on your strategy, on your aggressiveness parameter, to say that the aggressiveness parameter is bigger than this small m, but smaller than this big m. So in this case, you really restrict the possibility for the first populations to win. Sometimes the winning strategy really requires a very high level of aggressiveness. If you reduce the level of aggressiveness with a big M, you may lose winning strategies when rho is different than one. When rho is equal to one, they are the same. Speaking about this this set AMM, the next question that we discussed briefly at the beginning was whether or not you can find a strategy that minimizes the duration of the war. This, I think, it is maybe the most important question in practice, because in the model, we did not take into account how wearing the war is, even for the first population. I mean, psychologically, a long war is going to logorate people, and this has an effect, of course, on the outcome of the war. So in a model like this, you are clearly interested in the strategies that lead not only to the victory of the first population, but they lead to the victory of the first population as fast as possible. So again, if you have a strategy A, which admits a possible victory, we call T of A the winning time corresponding to this strategy. And so we look at the minimal possible time. So we call T tilde the minimum of T of A among the admissible strategies in this set. And the for this, well, I, I think that Lyle was in the audience, so I'm very happy that he was around, because this is probably the part that Lyle is gonna like, because we use Pontryagin principle to describe the optimal strategy that leads to the minimizing time. So this is, I think, also a cute thing from the theoretical point of view, because most of the situations in which Pontryagin principle is exploited in optimal control lead to what people call bang-bang strategies, so situations in which the optimal strategy takes the minimum and the maximal possibility. So if you see, we had this set A and M, in which we were constraining strategies to be between little m and big M, right? So a bang-bang strategy is typically a strategy which starts from one of the two value and jumps to the next one, okay? This would be somehow what we would expect to be minimizing for the duration of the war. I mean, that was actually our first guess. Consider that this guess was motivated actually by the fact that heavy side functions were sufficient. So there is an optimal strategy with just one jump. So the natural guess is that if you jump from the minimum to the maximum at the appropriate time, this is also going to minimize the duration of the war. So we thought that minimizing the duration of the war was just to select the right time in which you have to choose to switch between the two different minima and maxima aggressiveness parameters. But this is not the case. This is not the case. If you run Pontryagin principle in this situation, you have a degenerate situation, which may happen, but usually doesn't. And so this degenerate situation produces an interpolating arc that we call AEST, which can be explicitly described in terms of the corresponding orbit. So if U tilde and V tilde is the corresponding orbit of the dynamical system, is an interpolating arc, which is not small m, is not big m, it's something in between. And so the theorem is that the optimal strategy only attains three values. So the little m, the big m, or this interpolating arc. And yes, so the strategy, so in principle, this is a mathematical theorem, right? It just tells you that it is possible that the optimal strategy also has to follow this singular arc. But we think that it's actually an optimal theorem in the sense that it's not possible to remove the singular part from the optimal strategies. And let me show a picture for that. So this is a numerical simulation for some initial condition with some parameters for the birth rate, the damages, and for instance, little m equal to zero. So the minimum is zero aggressiveness, the maximum is aggressiveness equal to 10. And in the next picture in blue, I will describe the strategy, the optimal strategy that minimizes the duration of the war, and in red, the values of this strange singular curve here. So if you see this picture, here you only, I mean, at least I only see the red, but the reason is that the red and the blue are one over the other. So here, the the blue, which would be the optimal strategy, coincides with the singular arc, then here the blue jumps and reaches level 10. So, of course, when you see this picture, you can say, forget about the singular arc. This level here is just zero. So it looks like that the optimal strategy is zero and then jumps to 10. But it's not like this. If you really look, the level zero is a little bit below this level. And if you don't believe me, look at this picture. Now the level zero, you see it here, is really below this level. This level starts at 0.1 or something. It looks like to me 0.1. It's not perfectly constant. You see here on this side, it looks to me as a little bit higher than here. So it's really an arc. Then the arc would follow the red part, but the strategy jumps to 10. So the optimal strategy in this case from the numerical simulation follows the singular arc for quite a long time, so 240 seconds or whatever, and then jumps to the maximal threshold. So this is a case in which we think that the optimal arc is really obtained. So I think it's time for me to stop here, and I think that's it.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Enrico, for your interesting talk. There are questions?
Yes, Pasquale, there are two hands up.
Please. Giuseppe Vigliaroro, please.
Grazie tante, Pasquale, grazie tante, Enrico, per la tua bellissima presentazione. I have just a curiosity. Are you aware about some researches which include also the space variable for U and V? So, for instance, diffusion terms or drift terms?
Yes, that's what we would like to do now.
Okay. It's not very easy, I guess.
Well, I mean, it's just that I'm weak, right? So I like always to start with easy things. So here, already treating all this in detail took a very long paper. It's like 100 pages long, after all. So even doing the easy case, it's not easy at all. I mean, if you really want to do it and treat all the cases and understand the roles of the parameters and discuss the optimal strategies, even without diffusion, even for the ODE case was not easy at all. So we decided that for one time we could try to be interested in dynamical systems more than in PDEs. So we focused on that.
This is an optimal strategy, I guess.
Well, it's what you do when you are not too good, right? You start with the easiest, simple possibility.
But I totally agree.
Our next goal would be to put diffusion in it and to understand the role of diffusion.
Thank you.
Okay, Umberto Guarnotta, please.
Thank you. Ciao Enrico. Thank you for your great talk and very interesting talk. I have a maybe trivial question and a curiosity. The question is, do you obtain, as in Lotka Volterra model, periodic solutions? And the curiosity is if you add a delay in the aggressiveness function, adding a delay affects the dynamics of the model or not?
I didn't understand the second one.
If you add a delay on the time on the aggressive function, if you consider a delay differential equation, do you obtain a different dynamics or not?
Yeah, so that's the thing. So right now we only did the easy thing, but I agree that there are a number of things that would be nice to be considered with respect to the even without diffusion. So you are saying that one should take into account a delayed equation or an equation with memory. Yes, I agree. These are interesting questions. We didn't do that because, of course, the theory would be more complicated. So we started from the standard dynamical system theory in 2D. So, of course, another interesting thing would be, what if you have three populations? But again, so maybe you can, but it's so nice to draw pictures. So the 2D case is somehow easier to start with, and classical ODEs with Cauchy problems, in a sense, were for us more handy. About the first thing, I think that this is somehow the main difference with respect to the typical predator and prey situation. So predator and prey bases its foundation on the idea that the predators are dummy. So they encounter the prey randomly without seeking for it. So the term of the predation is the product of the two variables. Here we are speaking about intelligent populations, even if I think that making a war is stupid, so maybe not too intelligent, but intelligent enough to pursue the objective consciously. So it's not that they encounter randomly, there is really an intentional term for which the first population devotes a proportion of its density to go and attack the second one. And the damage is proportional to the number of the soldiers involved, in a sense. And so the picture is somehow, it's somehow different. If you see both when AC is less than one and when AC is bigger than one, you don't have this situation of circles around equilibria. So the equilibria end up, except in the case AC equal to one, which is the generate, but when AC is different than one, it's what I used to call it a hyperbolic equilibrium. I'm not sure that everybody call it like that, but I mean that the eigenvalues are different than zero. And so they really produce nearby linearized equation, which drives the motion with an exponential rate. And even when AC is equal to one, in which case this red dot clashes into the origin, and the origin as a degenerate direction, the qualitative picture would be somehow this one on the right. So there is no production of circles and periodic orbits of this type.
Okay, thank you, Enrico.
Okay, Surra Mosconi, please.
Hello, Enrico. I have a very quick question. Do you have numerics of one of these non-bang-bang strategies when the bottom level is not zero?
No, we didn't push the numerics very hard.
But you think that maybe the fact that you have zero aggressiveness is what causes this
could be. No, I agree. We should run more simulations. I fully agree.
Because the zero aggressiveness is of course, that is doing nothing.
But you are not forced to choose zero, right? I mean, it's just a possibility. Mm-hmm. Because the values of the aggressiveness was posed between zero and 10. So you are not forced to choose zero.
Yes, but if you want to minimize the time, of course, having zero aggressiveness, it doesn't make the trick, or not. I don't know it. I was just wondering if this phenomenon was maybe caused by this choice of zero as a bottom level. I don't know.
I don't know, because consider that the cost was quite high. You see, C was equal to 4 in this simulation, the cost of the war. So it's not evident that making the war is actually worthwhile. And this is the reason for which the zero aggressiveness is almost reached, right? So you have this long path, which is almost... is almost zero, but you may be right. Maybe if you force the aggressiveness to be at least one, you lose this. I don't know. We should run more simulations. I agree.
And then one curiosity. Have you tried minimizing losses?
Yes, that's
strategies which minimize human losses.
Yes, that's also something we want to do. We want to try to maximize U at the time big T. So if big T is the extinction time for V, you want to maximize U of big T, right?
Yes.
Which is the same as what you are saying, that
you
want to minimize the losses for the aggressive population. So to maximize the individuals remaining.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, now Lyle Noakes, please.
Yes, hello. Thank you, Enrico. That was a lovely talk. Just one thought before you go to diffusion and other ways of making this more sophisticated. One thought I had was that the non-aggressive population, that's a remarkable assumption, really. I mean, it's much more likely, isn't it, that you have both populations aggressive to some degree. And if you were to allow some sort of strategy for the second population, then you have something like a differential game. And there's a Pontryagin principle available for that also. So, I mean, is that something worth considering, do you think?
Absolutely. Actually, so if I were you, I would consider a great compliment what I'm going to tell you. So Elisa discussed his thesis the last week or so, and the committee was chaired by Henri Berestiki, which is probably the biggest expert in models of mathematical biology and so, and that was precisely his question. So I think it's a very, very, very interesting question. Yes, so this is also something we should do. Since you are here, it would be very, very, very nice to discuss with you about it, because I think, this is a very extreme simplification in which one population is basically pacific, even if the first population is aggressive. And the first question of Henri Berestiki was whether or not, for instance, all these results are stable if you put a small reaction of the second population. This is one thing that is really worth exploring. And as you said, also trying to understand the optimal strategies in this more complicated situation is a very, very nice thing to exploit. And I think we have to discuss more about it.
Yes, thank you, Enrico. It's remarkable.
You have to teach me a bit of optimal control, because I'm a bit profane.
I don't think I can teach you anything, but it's remarkable also the optimal strategy you compute with your numerics. It's remarkable actually that it's optimal not to be aggressive for a very long time, not to be very aggressive for a very long time. I think that's quite remarkable. It's quite unexpected, I would have thought. But, Anyway, thank you very much again for a lovely
talk. It is somehow a philosophical thing also, because the fact that the Bang Bang strategies are always possible really suggests that the sneaky way of a little bit cheaty, right? You are not aggressive and then you are very, very aggressive. That turns out to be a very effective way of destroying the opponent. That may actually happen in real life. Maybe we should study a little bit of history as well, because I suspect that...
I'm thinking Hitler and Stalin. I mean, this was a little bit like this in the Second World War, perhaps. Anyway, thank you.
Okay. There are other questions, remarks? Just a curiosity, Enrico. The parameter C is involved just in one equation?
Yes, because it's somehow the cost, we call it the cost of the war, because let's see the equations, right? So, yes, so the parameter C only occurs here, because so what is the idea? The idea is that a fraction of the people from the first population are sent to the war, so they don't contribute to the reproduction of the first population, but they cause the damage to the second. Now you can scale time to say that the damage that they produce is equal to one. So there is a parameter here which is hidden, which is one. And so C is how much costs to the first population to send the soldier to war, given that one is the effectiveness of the strike. If you want, this C is just the ratio between zeta 1 and zeta 2 after reparametrization.
Okay. Enrico, thank you again for your interesting work, for the discussion. We hope to see you face to face in Taormina in the next year. Thank you again. Good days, and thank you, all the best.
Thank you, and thanks for the patience of being here on such a day as well.
Thank you.
Okay, we stop here, and the next talk will be April 1st at 4 p.m., and there will be the talk of Professor Petru Jebelian. If you like, in that occasion, we make the Eastern greetings together. Okay? Thank you.
Of course.
See you.